بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome you all to our lesson number 43 in the book Alumdah في الفقه. And we are still going over the third portion of the book of fiqh, the third quarter. And we have reached the chapter of Babu Ishratin Nisa, a chapter on intermingling and showing kindness to the women, meaning the wives. So in this chapter, the author will talk about how to maintain the good relation with the one's spouse. So he started by saying, وعلى كل واحد من الزوجين معاشرة صاحبه بالمعروف. And it is incumbent upon each one of the spouses to maintain a life which includes kindness in the according to the norm, meaning to the norm of the people and according to the known relation that should be maintained between a husband and a wife. And of course, the proof for that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's statement, وَعَاشِرُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ فَإِنْ كَرِهْتُمُهُنَّ فَعَسَىٰ أَنْ تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَيَجْعَلَ اللَّهُ فِي خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. Allah commands that we maintain a life full with kindness. So this is Allah's injunction to mankind, to the Muslims, in regards to the relation between a wife and a husband. So if you dislike a behavior from her, perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may bring out good out of it. And we have a very living example is the life of the Prophet, peace be upon him. And he used to say, خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ وَأَنَا خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِي. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the best amongst you is the one who is good and best to his family. And I am the best to my family, meaning him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we have other hadith, like the hadith of the Prophet, peace be upon him, when he said, استوصوا بالنساء خيرا فإنهن عوان عندكم أخذتمهن بأمانة الله واستحللتم فروجهن بكلمة الله. Like in Sahih Muslim, he said, he admonished to be giving good care of the women. They are like a captive kept with you. And you have taken them by the security of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it became permissible for you to, meaning copulate with them, by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is again a bequest from the Prophet, peace be upon him, to maintain good relation with the spouses. And the author mentioned here, وَأَدَأُ حَقِّهِ الْوَاجِبِ لَهُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ غَيْرِ مَطْلٍ وَلَا إِظْهَارِ الْكَرَاهَةِ لِبَذْلِهِ. So while maintaining this kind relation, he should maintain the rights of the spouse without any hesitance or delay in giving the due rights and maintaining them, and without showing any hatred or dislike in maintaining this relation with the one's spouse. And he said, وَحَقُّهُ عَلَيْهَا تَسْلِيمُ نَفْسِهَا إِلَيْهِ. And amongst the male's right upon his wife is that she submits herself to him. وَطَاعَتْهُ فِي الْاسْتِمْتَاعِ مَتَى أَرَادَهُ. And she should obey him whenever he wants to have joy with her, meaning copulation and the like. So we have the hadith of the Prophet, peace be upon him, when he said, إِذَا بَاتَتِ الْمَرْأَةُ هَاجِرَةً فِرَاشَ زَوْجِهَا لَعَنَتْهَا الْمَلَائِكَةُ حَتَّى تَرْجِعَ. He said, if the woman sleeps or spends the night while she is abandoning the bed of her husband, the angels would curse her in this regard until she comes back to his bed. This is hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, to show the importance of this issue. Mainly, most of the evil that may spread in a community in regards to men going to spare their desire and their lust in means which are not permissible to them, may resort to the issue of marriage and maintaining good relation between a wife and a husband. So the evil of a woman keeping herself from her husband upon the male may lead to a greater evil, that he may seek the pleasure in an unlawful manner in this case. So this is why the burden of such a thing may fall upon the wife in this case, because she is a factor in maybe forcing her husband to go and search for an unlawful means to fulfill his lust and desire. At the same time, when we have a hadith that, like said by him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that if a woman prayed on time and fulfilled her husband's duty, then it will be said to her, enter paradise from any of the gates of paradise you wish. So look how much is founded upon the relation of a husband and a wife, and how much reward a person may collect from such relation. So she should submit herself to him, ما لم يكن لها عذر, unless she has an excuse, such as she may have menses or postpartum bleeding, or she is fasting and obligatory fasting, or she is in a state of Hajj or Umrah. In this case, this is an excuse in which she may abstain from responding to her husband if he desires to have a relation with her. And he said, وَإِذَا فَعَلَ ذَٰلِكَ فَلَهَا عَلَيْهِ قَدْرُ كِفَايَتِهَا مِنَ النَّفَقَةِ وَالْكِسْوَةِ وَالْمَسْكَنِ بِمَا جَرَتْ بِهِ عَادَةُ أُمْثَالِهَا. So if she maintained that relation with her husband and she showed submission to him, then it becomes incumbent upon him to spend on her needs, her clothing and accommodation, according to the norm of the women of her caliber. So if the norm of a woman's status or so is to spend upon her a specific amount of money and to buy her specific types of clothes of her level and status, which is the norm in the community, then the husband, to his best, should maintain that. But we do see that some scholars went to an opinion that it is based upon the ability, the financial ability of the husband. If he is financially capable to maintain the equivalent of women of her status expenses, then this is fine. But if his financial status is less than that, then he is to spend upon her according to his ability and so on. Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَسْكِنُوهُنَّ مِنْ حَيْثُ سَكَنْتُمْ مِنْ وُجْدِكُمْ. So give them the accommodation where you use to live according to your financial capabilities. Then he said, فَإِنْ مَنَعَهَا ذَلِكَ أَوْ بَعْضَهُ وَقَدَرَتْ لَهُ عَلَى مَالْ أَخَذَتْ مِنْهُ قَدْرَ كِفَايَتِهَا وَوَلَدِهَا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. And then he mentioned here, if he abstained from spending upon her, covering her expenses and clothing, accommodation and so on, then in this case she may take from him according to the norm that covers her need and her children's need. And this is based on the hadith of the Prophet, peace be upon him, like the author mentioned here, when Hind, حين قالت هند بنت عتبة, the wife of Abu Sufyan, she said to Prophet, peace be upon him, أن أبا سفيان رجل شحيح وليس يعطيني من النفقة ما يكفيني وولدي فقال, or ما يكفيني وولدي فقال, خذي ما يكفيك وولدك بالمعروف. Like in Bukhari and Muslim. So she complained to the Prophet, peace be upon him, that Abu Sufyan is a stingy man and he does not spend upon her in a manner that suffices her needs and her children. Then he said to her, you may take from him whatever suffices you and your children according to the norm. And then the author said, وَإِنْ لَمْ تَقْدِرْ عَلَى الْأَخْذِ لُعُسْرَتِهِ أَوْ مَنْعَهَا فَاخْتَارَتْ فِرَاقَهُ فَرَّقَ الْحَاكِمُ بَيْنَهُمَا سَوَاءٌ كَانَ الزَّوْجُ كَبِيرًا أَوْ صَغِيرًا. If she chose or he were not able to spend upon her because of his impoverishment, or he abstained from spending upon her, and she has chosen to separate from him, then this is to be done through the court. So the judge would do such a thing, whether the husband was old or young. Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَإِمْسَاكُمْ بِمَعْرُوفٍ أَوْ تَسْرِيحٌ بِإِحْسَانٍ. So either to maintain the husband-wife relationship with kindness, or to separate also similarly with kindness. And then he said, وَإِنْ كَانَتْ صَغِيرَةً لَا يُمْكِنُ الْإِسْتِمْتَاعُ بِهَا. And if she were, meaning the wife, she was young, he cannot copulate with her. If she is less than the age of puberty, or even reach the age of puberty, and she is not fit for copulation by either staying at her parents' house, in this case, it's not incumbent upon the husband to cover her expenses or pay her expenses until she grows up and she moves to his house. And now we'll mention other cases in which it's not obligatory upon him to spend upon his wife. And the second case is, أَوْ لَمْ تُسَلِّمْ أَوْ لَمْ تُسَلِّمْ إِلَيْهِ, meaning that أَوْ لَمْ تُسَلَّمْ إِلَيْهِ, meaning that she was not given to him. She remained at her parents' house, even if she were old, but she remained at her parents' house. She was not given to him, in this case, is not to spend upon her. أَوْ لَمْ تُطِعْهُ فِي مَا يَجِبُ لَهُ عَلَيْهَا. If she chose not to obey him in whatever he instructs her to do, which is a right for her to do for him. In this case, he has the right not to spend upon her. أو سافرت بغير إذنه, or she traveled without his permission. Although this is another reason in which, according to the madhab, he is not to spend upon her. أو بإذنه في حاجتها, or even if she traveled with his permission for something she needs. Here the madhab is, it's not obligatory upon him to spend upon her and cover her expenses. But other scholars went to opinion, if he had given her permission to travel, again, it is obligatory upon him to spend upon her. And then the author moved to a chapter. He said, وَلَهَا عَلَيْهِ الْمَبِيتُ عِنْدَهَا لَيْلَةً مِنْ كُلِّ أَرْبَعٍ إِنْ كَانَتْ حُرَّةً. And now we'll talk about the spending the night with his wife and how much he should maintain the relation, and amongst this relation is to copulate with her. So he said it is incumbent upon him to spend the night. Out of four. إِنْ كَانَتْ حُرَّةً, if she were a free woman. Of course, this is based on if he were married to four women and he needs to divide the time between the four women, each day he'll be spending the night with one of them. So here he's saying that if he has only one woman, then it is obligatory upon him at least to spend one night out of four with his wife, if she were a free woman. وَمِنْ كُلِّ ثَمَانٍ إِنْ كَانَتْ أَمَةً. If he were married to a slave woman, like we have mentioned earlier in previous chapters, there are cases, the norm is that a free man is not permissible for him to marry a slave woman. A free man is not permissible for him to marry a slave woman unless he was unable to cover the expenses of marrying a free woman, and he cannot hold his lust. He fears that he may go and commit adultery or so. In this case, the Sharia had given him the permission to go and marry a slave woman. If that happens, then here the author is telling us that if for the free woman is 1 out of 4 nights he should spend with his wife, in the case of a slave woman, it's 1 out of 8 nights he must spend with his slave wife. إِذَا لَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ عُذْرٌ. If he had no excuse. وَإِصَابَتُهَا مَرَّةً فِي كُلِّ أَرْبَعَةِ أَشْهُرٍ. Now he talks about the issue of how often should he copulate with his wife. So he mentions here that he should at least copulate with her once every 4 months, if he has no excuse. Meaning that this is the maximum time span in which he cannot stay any longer than that without copulating with his wife. So this is the case where we do have in the Sharia the issue of al-ila. The ila means for the husband, if he swears not to copulate with his wife for a specific time. And this was a practice of Jahiliyyah before Islam. So Islam came and corrected this issue. So if a man swears not to touch his wife, not to copulate with her, the Sharia gave a limit of 4 months. Allah said, لِلَّذِينَ يُؤْلُونَ نِسَائِهِمْ تَرَبُّصُوا أَرْبَعَةِ أَشْهُرِ لِلَّذِينَ يُؤْلُونَ مِنْ نِسَائِهِمْ تَرَبُّصُوا أَرْبَعَةِ أَشْهُرِ. So for those who swear not to touch their wives, they are given a limit time up to 4 months. فَإِنْ فَاءُوا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. If they go and copulate with their wife, then Allah is the oft forgiving, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, because they made a swear or an oath not to touch their wife, if they go and copulate with their wives, they must give the expiation of not maintaining the oath. So here the author is telling us that the maximum time in which he may abstain from having sexual relation with his wife is 4 months in this case. فَإِنْ آلَ مِنْهَا أَكْثَرَ مِنْ أَرْبَعَةِ أَشْهُرٍ فَتَرَبَّصَتْ أَرْبَعَةَ أَشْهُرٍ ثُمَّ رَافَعَتْهُ إِلَى الْحَاكِمِ فَأَنْكَرَ الْإِلَاءَ أَوْ مُضِّيَ الْأَرْبَعَةِ أَشْهُرٍ أَوْ ادَّعَ أَنَّهُ أَصَابَهَا وَكَانَتْ ثَيِّبًا فَالْقَوْلُ قَوْلُهُ مَعَ يَمِينِهِ وَإِنْ أَقَرَّ بِذَلِكَ. So he said here, if he made إِلَاء, meaning he swear, he made an oath not to touch her more than 4 months, then she has the right to wait for this entire 4 months. And she may report him to the judge in this case. So the Islamic ruling is that if a man swears not to touch his woman, the Sharia gives him a maximum time of 4 months. In which, within this time, if he does not copulate with his wife, then she has the right to go to the judge and report him to him. The author mentions here, if this case happens and the husband denied that he made ila, he had made an oath not to touch her, or he claimed that the 4 months had passed already. Or he claimed that he touched her already, and she was a non-virgin. Then what the author is saying here, that the judge may take his statement with his oath. So he makes an oath that he is telling the truth. If he claims such a thing, that he had denied the ilah, that he made an oath not to touch her, or the 4 months completed, he claimed that the 4 months had completed already, or he said he already copulated with her and she was a non-virgin, then the judge in this case may take his statement, while also he asks him to swear and to make an oath that he is telling the truth. But if he admits that he did not touch her for 4 months, he is commanded, أُمِرَ بِالْفَيْئَةِ وَهِيَ الْجِمَعِ, he is commanded to copulate with her. And if he does, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ, the of forgiving. But if he does not, وَإِنْ لَمْ يَفِئْ أُمِرَ بِالطَّلَاقِ, but if he does not copulate with his wife and it exceeded 4 months, then in this case, and he refuses to comply with the ruling of the judge by copulating with his wife, then he is commanded by the judge to divorce his wife. فَإِن طَلَّقَ وَإِلَّا طَلَّقَ الْحَاكِمُ عَلَيْهِ, so either that man, he makes the talaq, and if he refuses to make the talaq, then the hakim makes a judgment for the talaq to take place and happen, and this is by the ruling of the court, that this woman is a divorced woman based on the judgment of the hakim, the judge. ثُمَّ إِنْ رَاجَعَهَا أَوْ تَرَكَهَا حَتَّى بَانَتْ ثُمَّ تَزَوَّجَهَا وَقَدْ بَقِيَ أَكْثَرُ مِنْ مُدَّةِ الْإِلَاءِ وُقِفَ لَهَا كَمَا وَصَفَتْ. Now he mentions that if she were divorced based on ila, meaning that the husband swore that he would not touch her for a specific time. So the Sheikh here is giving an example. If somebody made an oath not to touch his wife for a full year, so after 4 months, she was divorced by the judge. So how many months are remaining? Are 8 months. So what if the man decided to return his wife? Because if he makes a first talaq, either by him or the judge, then he may return her within the waiting period. If he returns her, and again he abstains from copulating with her, he is given again another 4 months. And if he complies with her by copulating with her, then the issue of ila is done. There is no ila anymore, that he had returned to his wife. But if the 4 months passes and he does not copulate with her, and she complains to the judge again, the same thing may happen again, which is the judge may ask him to return and copulate with his wife, or he may force him to make talaq. And if he abstains from making talaq, divorce, the judge may rule the talaq. وَمَنْ عَجَزَ عَنِ الْفَيْئَةِ عِنْدَ طَلَبِهَا, and whomever fails to copulate with his wife when she requested, let him say, whenever I can, I will copulate with her. وَيُؤَخَّرُ حَتَّى يَقْدِرْ عَلَيْهَا, and he's kept until he is able to do so. And then the author moves to another chapter, which is بَابُ الْقَسْمِ وَالنُّشُوزِ. And this is the chapter of how a man who is married to more than a woman, how should he divide the time amongst them? And how should they deal if there is any misbehavior from any of the husband and the wives? So he started by saying, وَعَلَى الرَّجُلِ أَن يُسَاوِيَ بَيْنَ نِسَائِهِ فِي الْقَسْمِ, it is incumbent upon the husband to deal equally with his wife in assigning the number of nights for each one of them. Of course, like in the previous chapter, when we talk about spending the night amongst the wife, not necessarily spending the night means copulation. So he may give each one of them one night, and he may copulate with one of them and not the others. So not necessarily spending the night entails that he should copulate. The issue of copulation, not necessarily he has to maintain the equality here. And like you said here, rahimahullah ta'ala, وَعِمَادُ الْقَسْمِ اللَّيْلُ فَيَقْسِمُ لِلْأَمَةِ لَيْلَةً وَلِلْحُرَّةِ لَيْلَتَيْنِ. So, if he's married to a free woman, he gives her, of course, the measure of spending a time with a wife is the night, because this is the time where normally people sleep in, and they do not sleep during the day, of course. But if a person was someone who has night shifts and he works during the night and he usually sleeps during the day, then the measure in dividing the time amongst the wives is based upon spending the days with each one of them. So the norm is that people usually spend the night with their wives. So he gives for the slave woman one night, and for the free woman, free wife, two nights. He said, وَإِنْ كَانَتْ كِتَابِ, even if that free woman is a woman of the book, meaning a Jew or a Christian, she is to be dealt with like a free Muslim. Like he mentioned here also, وَلَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ الْمُسَاوَاتُ بَيْنَهُنَّ فِي الْوَطْئِ, and it's not incumbent upon him to copulate with them equally. The issue of equality here is based upon just spending the night with them. And of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran about maintaining the time and giving the right share for all the women. Allah said, فَلَا تَمِيلُوا كُلَّ الْمَيْلِ فَتَذَرُوهَا كَالْمُعَلَّقَةِ. So do not take one side by leaving the other wives. So you go toward one of them and give her more time than the other. This is an issue of injustice, which the Sharia abhors. Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَلَّا تَعْدِلُوا فَوَاحِدَةً أَوْ مَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ. And if you fear not to maintain justice in the time shares amongst the wives, then you should have only one wife in this case. وليس له البداءة في القسم بإحداهن ولا السفر بها إلا بقرعة. He said, if he had more than one wife and he wants to put a time share between them, he should not start with the first one except by casting a lot. So he should cast a lot to see which one will be picked up to be the first one in the schedule. So he cannot just pick himself and decide which one he should start with. No, even the issue of starting in the time schedule should be based on casting a lot, and based on the result of that, that woman will be the first one to spend the two nights with. Similarly, the case if he wants to travel and he wants to take a wife, one of his wives with him, again, he should draw a lot and see whomever wins, she is to go with him. This is for the first one. When the next time he travels, he excludes the first one and he draws a lot based on the remaining wives. So whomever is picked up, she is to go and travel with him. And this is based on the hadith of the Prophet, peace be upon him, like the author mentioned here. فَإِنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ كَانَ إِذَا أَرَادَ سَفَرًا أَقْرَعَ بَيْنَ نِسَائِهِ فَأَيَّتُهُنَّ خَرَجَ سَهْمُهَا خَرَجَ بِهَا مَعَهُ. So whenever he, peace be upon him, decides to travel, he would cast a lot to choose the first one that will go with him in this first trip. And in the next trip, he also cast a lot for the remaining wives. So the first one who had traveled with him already, she is excluded from the next draw in this case. This is like the hadith of Aisha and Bukhari Muslim. وَلِلْمَرْأَةِ أَن تَهَبَ حَقَّهَا مِنَ الْقَسْمِ لِبَعْضِ ضَرَائِرِهَا بِإِذْنِ زَوْجِهَا أَوْ لَهُ فَيَجْعَالُهُ لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْهُنَّ. He said, it is up to the woman to give her share of the knights to some of his co-wives by his permission, or she may give it to him, and then he decides to whom he wants to give it from amongst his wives. This happened with the second wife of the Prophet, peace be upon him, Sauda bint Zum'a radiallahu anha, when she became very old and she feared that the Prophet may leave her. So she said to him, you may give my knight to Aisha. So she gave her knight for Aisha radiallahu anhunna. So, فَكَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمْ يَقْسِمُ لِعَائِشَةَ يَوْمَهَا وَيَوْمَ سَوْدَى. So he used to, صلى الله عليه وسلم, after that, give the night of Sauda to Aisha رضي الله عنهم. وَإِذَا عَرَّسَ عَلَى بِكْرٍ أَقَامَ عِنْدَهَا سَبْعًا. Now if he marries a new wife and she is a virgin, then he is entitled to stay with her for 7 nights. ثم دار, and then he makes the same night's division share amongst the remaining wives. وَإِنْ عَرَّسَ عَلَى ثَيِّبٍ أَقَامَ عِنْدَهَا ثَلَاثًا. But if he marries a woman who is a divorced or a widow who was married already before, then he may stay with her for 3 nights. And this is based on the statement of Anas radiallahu anhu when he said, مِنَ السُّنَّةِ إِذَا تَزَوَّجَ الْبِكْرَ عَلَى الثَّيِّبِ أَنْ يُقِيمَ عِنْدَهَا سَبْعًا وَإِذَا تَزَوَّجَ الثَّيِّبَ عَلَى الْبِكْرِ أَقَامَ عِنْدَهَا ثَلَاثًا. So he said from the sunnah that whomever marries a virgin, he may stay with her for 7 nights. And if he marries a non-virgin, then he may stay with her for 3 nights. فَإِنْ أَحَبَّتِ الثَّيِّبُ أَنْ يَقِيمَ عِنْدَهَا سَبْعًا فَعَلْ. And if the non-virgin desired that he stay with her for 7 nights, he may do so. ثُمَّ قَضَاهُنَّ لِلْبَوَاقِي. Because he had given her 4 days extra, then again he should give the remaining wives similar 4 days. Should be divided for the remaining wife. Each one of her, the other wives may get 4 days in addition. لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لما تزوج أم سلمة أقام عندها ثلاثا. Because the Prophet, peace be upon him, when he married Umm Salama رضي الله عنها, he stayed with her for 3 nights because she was a non-virgin. ثم قال, he said, ليس بك هوان على أهلك إن شئت سبعت لك وإن سبعت لك سبعت لنساء. Said, if you wish, I will give you 7 nights. And if I do so, I'll do the same thing with my remaining women. And then the author goes to another chapter and by saying, وَيُسْتَحَبُّ التَّسَتُّرُ عِنْدَ الْجِمَعِ. It is recommended that a person be in private whenever he copulates with his wife, and to say the dua of copulation, like it is narrated by Ibn Abbas, said here by the author, that the Prophet, peace be upon him, said, لو أن أحدكم إذا أتى أهله قال بسم الله اللهم جنبنا الشيطان وجنب الشيطان ما رزقتنا فقضي بينهما ولد لم يضره الشيطان أبدا. And this hadith, the Prophet, peace be upon him, said, if the one of you comes to his wife, meaning in copulation, and he says before that, Bismillah, in the name of Allah, Allahumma jannibna shaytan, Allah, keep the shaytan away from us and keep him from what you provide for us, meaning a child. And if Allah decrees that there is a son conceived by his wife, the shaitan will not be able to harm him at all. And this is like the hadith in Bukhari and Muslim. And then he moved to another chapter, which is related to an-nushuz, to show disobedience or rebellion against the husband or the wife. So he said here, وَإِنْ خَافَتِ الْمَرْأَةُ مِنْ زَوْجِهَا نُشُوزًا أَوْ إِعْرَابًا فَلَا بَأْسَ أَنْ تَسْتَرْضِيَهُ بِإِسْقَاطِ بَعْضِ حُقُوقِهَا كَمَا فَعَلَتْ سَوْدَةُ حِينَ خَافَتْ أَنْ يُطَلِّقَهَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. So he's saying here, if a woman feared some rebellion from her husband or shows no interest in her, then it is fine for her to give up some of her rights in order to maintain the relation of this family. Like Sauda did, the second wife of the Prophet, radiallahu anha, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when she feared that the Prophet may divorce her. So she gave her night to Aisha radiallahu anha, meaning that in order to maintain that the Prophet keep her, she decided to give some of her rights in this case. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِنْ إِمْرَأَةٌ خَافَتْ مِنْ بَعْلِهَا نُشُوزًا أَوْ إِعْرَابًا فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِمَا أَنْ يُصْلِحَ بَيْنَهُمَا صُلْحًا. So if a woman feared, like Allah said, from her husband that he may turn away from her or show disobedience, no interest in her, then there is no blame upon them to reconcile. أَنْ يُصْلِحَ بَيْنَهُمَا وَالصُّلْحُ خَيْرٌ. And reconciling is good, meaning that she may give some of her rights in order to maintain the family bond here. And the opposite here is mentioned by the Shaykh. وَإِنْ خَافَ الرَّجُلُ نُشُوزَ امْرَأَتِهِ وَعَضَهَا فَإِنْ أَظْهَرَتْ نُشُوزًا هَجَرَهَا فِي الْمَضْجِعِ فَإِنْ لَمْ يَرْدَعْهَا ذَلِكَ فَلَهُ أَنْ يَضْرِبَهَا ضَرْبًا غَيْرَ مُبَرِّحٍ. So if the man feared that the woman is showing rebellion or she is displaying disobedience to him, then the first thing that he may do is to abandon her in bed, meaning not to copulate with her. And if this did not hold her from showing that disobedience, then he may give her an advice to stop behaving in a such manner. So first he should give her a da'wah. He should advise her. First he should, like he said, he give her an advice to make her stop misbehaving or showing disobedience. If this advice did not work out, then he may resort to the second solution, which is to abandon her in bed. He does not copulate with her. And if this second solution does not work out, the Sharia places the third solution, which is he may beat her in a manner that does not leave a mark on her body. Not a severe beating, of course. And what is meant by the beating here, of course, we were told to avoid the face. But it is a type of beating that leaves no mark on the body. And again, such an issue, we do see some of the non-Muslims using such ayat that talks about this solution that the Sharia offers to maintain the unity of the Muslim household. We look into the practice of the Prophet, peace be upon him, and that he had never beaten a woman, nor did the close companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and radiallahu anhum. So this is a very offered solution by the Sharia, in which to keep this household intact. We do know the consequences of the fall apart of the unity of a household. When a woman separates from her husband, and especially there are children there, and what is the outcome of that happening, and how much evil will get into the children and this household for not maintaining its unity. So the Sharia is offering some solution, and some solutions may be harsh a bit, but the outcome is good at the end. For instance, when the Sharia instructs that if a person steals and he meets the stipulations of stealing, in this case, the Sharia, what does it do to amputate such evil act from the community? It instructs that thief's hand is to be cut. So the cutting the hand is harsh and severe. But what's the output of that? What's the outcome of that? The outcome is the security and the unity and the safety of the entire community. Again, when it comes to the issue of the wife beating, this is to maintain the unity of the household, which is the nucleus of the greater community. By doing that, this is an offered solution by the Sharia to maintain the family as one and not to dismantle this structure which is holy and glorified in the Sharia. So this is Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala in the ayah of An-Nisa, he said that if a man fears that she shows rebellion or disobedience, وَاللَّاتِ تَخَافُونَ نُشُوزَهُنَّ فَعِظُوهُنَّ وَهْجُرُوهُنَّ فِي الْمَضَاجِعِ وَضْرِبُوهُنَّ فَإِنْ أَطَعْنَكُمْ فَلَا تَبُغُوا عَلَيْهِنَّ سَبِيلًا. So if those whom you fear showing rebellion or disobedience, then the first thing you should do is admonish them, give them nasiha, give them advice, remind them of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if this does not work out with them, then you may resort to the second option offered by the Sharia. So you cannot jump to the third one without offering the first option. Then if you fail to do so with the first option, you may move to the second one, which is to abandon them in sleeping, not to copulate with them. And if this also fails to work out to maintain the good manners of that wife and not showing rebellion to her husband and not showing disobedience in maintaining his rights, then the last solution is to try to discipline her in a manner that does not leave a mark in her body. And then he said, وَإِنْ خِيفَ الشِّقَاقُ بَيْنَهُمَا بَعَثَ الْحَاكِمُ حَكَمًا مِنْ أَهْلِهِ وحكما من أهلها مأمونين يجمعان إن رأيا ويفرقان فما فعل من ذلك لزمهما. So he's saying here, if under all those solutions it did not work out, then the hakim may bring someone from her side and someone from his side, the husband's side, as rulers, and they should be credible and reliable. So whatever decision they come with, it is to be applied. If those representatives, arbitrators from both families, they decide that both of them should separate because they found that there is no way to maintain the unity of this family, then these two arbitrators may decide that both husband and wife separate. And if they decide that they remain based on what they observe from the relation between both of them, then both husband and wife should remain together. So this is the Sharia offered solution in order to maintain the unity of a Muslim household. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ شِقَاقَ بَيْنِهِمَا فابعثوا حكما من أهله وحكما من أهلها إن يريد إصلاحا يوفق الله بينهما. And if you fear that they would separate or get into a greater dispute, then you may bring an arbitrator from his side and another from her side as judges between them, and they may decide whatever is fit for both of them. Then the author moves to the chapter of Al-Khul'. Al-Khul' is a form of separation between a husband and a wife. But it happens actually from the woman's side. Of course, like we know in the Sharia, who is the one who has the right to divorce is the male, the husband. But the Sharia gave the woman also some form of a right in which if she disliked her husband or she feared that she would not be able to maintain his due rights, then she may pay a ransom in order to buy the separation from him. So if she pays for her separation, this is called khul' in the Sharia. So the author says, وَإِذَا كَانَتِ الْمَرْأَةُ مُبْغِضَةً لِلْرَجُلِ. So if the woman hated her husband, وَخَافَتْ أَنْ لَا تُقِيمَ حُدُودَ اللَّهِ فِي طَاعَتِهِ, and she feared that she may not maintain his due rights, فَلَهَا أَنْ تَفْتَدِيَ نَفْسَهَا مِنْهُ بِمَا تَرَاضَيَا عَلَيْهِ. She has the right to ransom herself, to separate from him according to what they agree upon. So this is why this is a solution from the Sharia. If the woman reached a level that she was discontent with her husband and she could not maintain his due right, then she is to pay money or anything which has value in order to ransom herself. Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَلَّا يُقِيمَ حُدُودَ اللَّهِ فَلَا جُنَاهَ عَلَيْهِمَا فِي مَفْتَدَتْ بِهِمْ. If you fear that both of them will not maintain the due relations, the mutual relation for each other, and then this is fine, there is no blame upon both of them if she pays a ransom to separate herself from him. And this is an issue of consensus between the ulama. So the woman has the right to ask for such a thing, but given that when she desires to separate from her husband, it is because she dislikes him, she is not satisfied with him, she is failing to show his due right, then she may ask for such a thing. But if she's looking to marry, for instance, someone else, and she wants to separate from him because of that, and he has, and she did not lose, like he was not bad with her, she it's not a matter of her disliking him, but she has another reason that has nothing to do with him, and she asks for khul, separation, it is haram upon her to do so. We have the hadith of Thawban that the Prophet, peace be upon him, said, أَيُّمَ امْرَأَةٍ سَأَلَتْ زَوْجَهَا الطَّلَاقِ مِنْ غَيْرِ بَأْسٍ فَحَرَامٌ عَلَيْهَا رَائِحَةُ الْجَنَّةِ. Any woman asked her husband for divorce with no reason, with no justified reason, then it is haram upon her to smell the fragrance of paradise. Meaning that this is a major sin for her to ask to be separated from her husband for no valid, legitimate reason. Then he said, وَيُسْتَحَبُّ أَنْ لَا يَأْخُذَ مِنْهَا أَكْثَرَ مِمَّا أَعْطَاهَا. And when she pays him as a ransom, it is recommended that he does not take more than what he had given her as a bridal dowry. So in this case, if she decides to separate from him, then he is not to take more than what he has paid for her as a dowry. This is the opinion here in the madhab, but the jumhur al-ulama, they say it's fine if he takes from her more than that, given that he is not forcing her to give him more. If she willingly gives him more than what he had given her, then this is fine to do so. But if he forces her to give him such amount of money, which is more than the dowry, which he had paid her, then this becomes an injustice. And this increase in the amount he asked her to pay him becomes haram. We have the story of the wife of Thabit ibn Qais, when she came to the Prophet, peace be upon him, and she said, I do not hold any flaw against him in his religion, in his belief, and in his manners. But I hate to do kufr after Islam, meaning that she runs short in maintaining his due right. She hated him, she disliked him, and she felt she would not be able to copulate or maintain his rights. So the Prophet told her, are you willing to give him back his garden, which he had given her as a dowry? She said, yes. Then she gave him his garden, and the Prophet separated between them, like in the hadith of Bukhari. And then he said, فَإِذَا خَالَعْهَا أَوْ طَلَّقْهَا بِعِوَضْ بَانَتْ مِنْهُ. If he makes khul' or talaq after she gives him the money, a ransom, here she becomes ba'in, meaning that they are separated and he cannot change his mind and return her, like in the case of talaq. Remember, in the case of talaq, if he makes the first talaq, within the waiting period, he has the right to return her. Here, in the case of the khul', he cannot return her unless he goes and he makes a new marriage offer to her, a new marriage contract, new dowry, and so on. So in the case of the khul', the ulama, they say, it is deemed to be fasq, an annulment of the marriage contract. It's not a talaq. So in the case of the annulment of the marriage contract, the woman does not wait the 3 months period in order for her to marry someone else. Here in the case of the khul, she only waits for 1 month to make sure that she is not pregnant. And after that period of 1 month, she is allowed to go and marry someone else in this case. So the issue of that being a fasq, remember the ayat of Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, At-talaq marratan fa-imsakun bima'rufin aw tasrihun bi-ihsan. In the next ayah, Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَإِن طَلَّقَهَا فَلَا تَحِلُّ لَهُ بَعْدُ حَتَّى تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا آخَرَ. So at-talaq marratan, the talaq is 2 times, meaning that the type of talaq in which he can return his wife. While in the next ayah, he said, فَإِن طَلَّقَهَا فَلَا تَحِلُّ لَهُ بَعْدُ حَتَّى تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا آخَرَ. If he divorces her, meaning the 3rd time, it's not permissible for him to return her unless she goes and marries someone else. In between these 2 ayat, the khul is mentioned. So Ibn Abbas used these 2 ayat to conclude and infer that the khul is not deemed to be talaq. Because if it is deemed to be talaq, then these 2 ayat will have 4 talaq instead of 3. Because at-talaq marratan, the talaq, the divorce is 2 times. And then he says subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَإِن طَلَّقَ at-talaq marratan فَإِمْسَاكُمْ بِمَعْرُوفٍ أَوْ تَسْرِيحٌ بِإِحْسَانٍ. And then he said the same ayah, فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِمَا فِي مَا افْتَدَتْ بِهِ. There is no blame upon both of them in what she pays as a ransom to separate herself from him. So this act, is, which is khul, deemed not to be talaq. Rather, it is a form of fasq. So that's why Ibn Abbas deduced from these two ayat that al-khul is not a talaq. And then he said, وَلَمْ يَلْحَقْهَا طَلَاقُهُ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ, meaning that if he makes a khul, of course, if he makes a khul, that becomes بَيْنُونَ, meaning that he cannot return her. After he makes khul, he cannot say, you are talaq, because the word talaq had happened to a woman who is not his wife, whether she were in a waiting period or not. Remember, the 1 month immense period is only a period for her to wait in order to marry someone else, but not a period for him to return her, like in the case of the talaq. In the case of the talaq, she waits for 3 months period of time. That 3 months period of time, within that time, he can return her without making a new marriage contract. But this is not the case in the case of al-khul', because it's an annulment. So the 1 month waiting period is only to ensure that she's not pregnant and she is applicable after that to marry someone else. And then he said, وَإِنْ وَيَجُوزُ الْخُلْعُ بِكُلِّ مَا يَجُوزُ أَنْ يَكُونَ صَدَاقًا. It is permissible to pay for the khul, whichever thing may be valid to be a dowry. Anything that is can be a dowry, whether it was a commodity or a usufruct, like we have mentioned in the case of the sadaq, a dowry. Also, it can be given in the case of al-khul' to separate the ransom paid for separation. وَبِالْمَجْهُولِ فَلَوْ قَالَتْ, or even something which is unknown, as long as it's worth a value, but it's unknown, it is fine also to declare such a thing. And he brings an example here. He said, فَلَوْ قَالَتْ أَخْلَعْنِي بِمَا فِي يَدَيَّ مِنَ الدَّرَهِمِ. If she says, whatever money I have in my hand, in my fist, closed fist, it is for you, and as ransom to separate me from you, it is fine to accept that. Or she says, وَمَا فِي بَيْتِي مِنَ الْمَتَاعِ, whatever furniture is in my house is yours, but separate from me. It is fine for her to do so, although we cannot, at that moment, you don't know how exactly is the cost of that item. But here in this case, the ambiguity on the amount of money to be given, it's not a factor in holding her from being free from him. So it is acceptable if she does say such a thing. And he said, وَلَهُ مَا فِيهِمَا, what's in his hand, in her hand. If she says, what's in my hand is yours, it's fine for him to take it. Or whatever is in my house is yours as furniture, it's fine for him to take it. وَإِنْ خَالَعْهَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدٍ فَخَرَجَ مَعِيبًا. If he accepts to take ransom from her, that he takes a slave. And there was a flaw in this slave. He said, فَلَهُ أَرْشُهُ أَوْ رَدُّهُ وَأَخْدُ قِيمَتِهِ. So he has two options. Either he takes the price difference. Like we said earlier, if somebody sells an item, a car, and then he finds a defect in this car, so he is entitled to get, either to return the item or to take the price difference between the defected car and the same car if it were not without a defect, the price of it. So here in this case, if this slave who has a flaw in him, he is entitled to either take the price difference or to return the entire slave and take the price of that slave. وَإِنْ خَرَجَ مَغْصُوبًا أَوْ حُرًّا فَلَهُ قِيمَتُهُ. If he asks for a slave to be given as a ransom, as the money for the khul', but then he found out that this man was a person, a slave who was taken by force from his owner, from his master, or he was actually a free man, in this case, he is entitled to get the price or the cost of that, an equivalent slave. ويصح الخلع من كل من يصح طلاقهم. The خلع can be happen from any person whom his طلاق is valid. Remember, we mentioned cases where maybe the husband may be a child. His father married him to another child girl, for instance, because he found that this family, he wants to maintain a relation with them. So he went on and he married his own child to the female child of the other family. This child has no right to make talaq. He's too young. So in the case of the khul, the same thing applies. So the only one who can make khul is the one who has the right to make divorce. وَلَا يَصِحُّ بَدْلُ الْعِوَضِ إِلَّا مِمَّنْ يَصِحُّ تَصَرُّفُ فِي الْمَالِ. And the one who gives the ransom should be an eligible person or mature person who is usually given, allowed to maintain or to conduct monetary transactions. So we have taken earlier that if a person is young and he's not financially mature to make monetary transactions, then in this case, such a female is not eligible to do any monetary transactions. Therefore, it's not acceptable that she gives a ransom to free herself or to separate herself from the husband. Only the person who is qualified to do monetary transactions is eligible to pay the amount of the khul, the money or the ransom in the khul case here. It's like when we mentioned in the case of bay' that he must be ja'iz al-tasarruf. He is permissible to hold and conduct monetary transactions. So he must be baligh, must be reach the age of puberty, and he must be aqil, sane, and he must be rashid, eligible or mature enough to hold and conduct monetary transactions. So we'll stop here inshallah ta'ala. And by this, we have completed the book of marriage. And coming class, we'll get into the book of talaq, divorce, inshallah ta'ala. Barakallahu feekum, wa jazakumullahu khaira, wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.